Assalamu alaikum. My name is Dr. Ghulam Mustafa. We are here to study the second lecture of agriculture economics. I hope you are all well and you have seen the and took the online lecture, first lecture. So let's start. This is our today's lecture, second lecture. Today we will discuss about once again introduction to agriculture economics, and we will see how the agriculture economics is interlinked with microeconomics and macroeconomics. We will study the microeconomic definitions and macroeconomic definitions, and then we will see how these can be linked to the agriculture economics. And after that we will study some scarcity choices and how farmer make the choices regarding production and consumption. And then we will come to the definition, a formal definition of agriculture economics. Then we will see the role of agriculture economics in developing countries and developed countries. And of course, after that, at the end, we will study some what are the jobs of agriculture economics and what does an agriculture economist do? What is and what are the main duties of the agriculture economist, and what are the main jobs at national and international level of agriculture economist? Yeah, we studied and we better know about the microeconomics and macroeconomics. Actually, what microeconomics, that the how people make their choices. When we come to the agriculture, we can say that how farmer make their choices. That's what macroeconomics is, a broader spectrum. That's how different economic sectors work together at macro level, and we will see how this is related to agriculture and agriculture trade and agriculture at the broader and national and international level. That's much related to the macroeconomics and some of the development economics and their theories. For instance, dualist development theories and how it is related to the agriculture economics. And most of the topics of the microeconomics and microeconomics, majority of the topics, not all, but majority of the topics, and we can apply these to the agriculture economics. So we can simply define in the way that we saw the microeconomics and macroeconomics. We can simply define a very carefully and very simple definitions. Very, very, very easy definition, you can say that. But we cannot, this definition, we cannot generalize, but a very snapshot of the agriculture, definition of agriculture economics. The agriculture economics is the application of economic principles to the agriculture. What actually we do in agriculture economics, that is we apply the principles of the economics in the agriculture economics. For instance, we have studied the theories in economics. We have studied the macroeconomic studies, theories and models. We will see either how these theories and models are linked to the agriculture economics. That is the very simple and comprehensive definitions. That is, agriculture economics is the application of the economic principles to the agriculture. For instance, if we see that the definition of microeconomics is the how the people make the choices from the scarce resources, we can say that how the farmer make the choices from the available constraints, income constraints, input constraints. He also, like other persons, a general public, any particular persons has, any particular businessman has some constraints. Of course, a farmer also have some constraints. That's input constraint, budget constraints. And in these in my point of view, farmer have more constraints. He have more constraints. So if he manage these resources to optimize his inputs, to maximize his profit, that is what agriculture economics is. What is the what main role of the farmer is, like other businessmen, farmer as a businessman, how he manage the resources. So this is a simple definition of agriculture economics. That is how different principles of macro, micro can be linked to the agriculture economics. Yeah, scope of agriculture economics, it's somehow different. Pure economists used to ask that agriculture economics is not like pure economics. This is a very debatable topic. If you have seen the any economist, recently some of the agriculture economists, they got the Nobel Prize. Actually, they worked on this Banerjee and Duflo, his wife Duflo, and some of contributor in this 2019 Nobel Prize winner. They actually worked on agriculture economics. Yeah, they worked on agriculture economics, how the farmer optimized the fertilizers. This is actually their work, and they got the Nobel Prize, and they are the economist. So I don't know why people differentiate the agriculture economics, and of course there are differences exist, but economics is a very broader topic, very broader discipline, and it has a lot of sub disciplines. I saw a lot of economists who work on the health economics, educational economics, transport economics, but they are the economist. But it's a dilemma here, particularly in Pakistan. I observed this is a dilemma. They mostly in some of the selection boards in Pakistan, they differentiate a lot agriculture economics. And this is what, when you are economist, if you work on trade, if you work on something else like transport economics, you are actually applying the economic principles on health economics. You are applying the economic principles on trade. You are applying the economic principles on poverty. You are applying the economic principles on all other sectors of the economics. And they are very much interlinked. So when they are the economist, why not we consider the agriculture economist as the economist? So when the economic principles in economics, health economics, in health, when economic principles are applied in health, that is called the health economics. For instance, you studied in a health economist studies how different medicines mean their cost benefit analysis. For example, cancer has different treatments. It has there are cancer plants, there's traditional medicines, there are chemotherapy, and the economist studies their cost benefit analysis, their demand of different medicines. When these economic principles are applied in economics, that is health economics. And that what economists do, that is not MBBS doctor do not do this one. This is what economists do. If you will see that, okay, an economist cannot work on health, then this health economics will remain untouched. And imagine if there will be a no demand supply in economics. And I remain surprised when I saw some of the recently due to the COVID-19 coronavirus, I studied some of the economics of the this diseases, economics of the this viral diseases. There are some topics are there. There are some a book is written on this one. That is how this different economics of different diseases are there. How this, and then we calculated the economics burden in that. What are the economics burden? And this is not any pure MBBS doctors do not do this one. That is what is the economics burden of the cancer. What are the economics burden of the any other disease, coronavirus. Nowadays, what economists are doing, what is the impact of coronavirus virus on education, what are the impact of coronavirus on education, health, transport, infrastructures, because coronavirus has affected almost all areas of life. So this what economists will do. So similarly here, when the economist works in agriculture, that's become agriculture economics. Demand of different crops, demand and supply of different crops, and how the farmer manage the scarce resources and basic resources, that's land, labor and capital. And one of the major resources, the natural resources, and natural resources are owned by, most of the natural resources are owned by the farmers. So in my point of view, that agriculture economists should not be like treated as somehow minority, because there are few universities are there that's pure agriculture university, and there is a somehow discrimination between pure economist and agriculture economist, and the principles and these things are remain same, and number of courses like agriculture economists, they are more. In agriculture economics, they study the application of the economics in more detail, particularly production economics. We studied the demand and supply, and agriculture economists studied in detail production economics, and we have discussed some of the books, and we will throughout this course, I will recommend some of the books regarding the agriculture economics, and that will be very, very helpful regarding the production economics. And then, of course, educational economics are there. Demand and supply of different schools and colleges, demand of the education is itself a broader topic, and there's a lot of work has done on this one. There are some of the applied, journals are there on particularly on educational economics. Similarly, transport economics, urban economics, and housing economics are a lot of. They have broader discipline and broader. They have broader discussion on this one, and this is all the economics and application of the economics in different sectors of the economics and different. Departments and different sectors, when the fundamental principles of economics are applied there, there's another discipline emerge. But these all worked are done by the economist, not like educationist, like any educationalist do not do this demand and supply. Economists do demand and supply. Similarly, any engineers do not do the, you know, one of the basic myth in production economics in across the border, that is the engineers are decided what to produce and how to produce. This is actually the work of the economist, what to produce and how to produce and how much to produce. This is the work of the economist, and these are the fundamental questions that need to be addressed, and what this agriculture this is what economists do. Similarly, when economist works as a manager in agriculture, that's another field originate, that is a farm economics or agriculture economics. This is the broader scope of agriculture economics. Then we have the we studied the choices in economics, that how people make the choices. Similarly, farmer decide how he make the choices regarding the crops. When the scarce resources are there, when there are number of, for example, this wheat production, there are different substitutes crops are there. Here, when the farmer decide what to produce, which crop is to produce, that is what farmer do. That is, there is a like bundle of crops are there, like substitute crops of wheat, and then we have barley, and we have some sugarcane, and farmer decide from the available resources, farmer decide what to produce, not even regarding the enterprises farmer decide. Like in another, in pure economics, when, for example, if you are given some resources, you decide either I have to run a shop, or I have to run a hotels, or I have to run a, any educational institutes. Do you have the choices? Similarly, farmer have the choices regarding the enterprises. Farmer make the choices regarding production of crops, rearing of the animals, livestock. These are the choices, and are forestry. Forestry is also, emerging economic resources. For example, bamboo production in Pakistan. Some of the farmers, instead of producing the crops, wheat and other things, they grow the forestry, and it gives a lot of, profits are there in forestry, and similarly in animal productions, and farmer make the choices. And farmer make the diversifications, can be combined two or three, business like livestock business, like crop business, like he can rent out his lands, and he can grow the forestry. And some mining and other things are also comes in, but this is somehow governments actually handle, like mining of salt. And this also comes under the agriculture. So there are three fundamental sources, that is our natural and resources, human resources, and manufacturing resources. And from these scarcity, that is scarcity what refer to the fixed quantity of resources that are available to meet the societal need. That's how farmer are doing. From the available scarce resources, he make the choices. And then we have some other, like when we have scarce resources, we have, it means we have alternatives. Like we have alternative to grow crops. What are the alternative to grow crops is the rearing the, or producing the livestock business, or poultry business, or forestry business. There are some alternatives. And all these alternative, what in pure economics we do, that is what alternative have the opportunity cost. Similarly, here the cost concept also comes in agriculture economics, that is to calculate the cost of the different alternatives, and there they have involved the opportunity cost. Like if I will start the business of poultry instead of the growing crops, and what are the earning from the growing crops, that will become the opportunity cost in animal production and milk production and poultry productions. And here in the, from these choices, we can say that they have, when they have alternative, next best alternative, and these alternatives have the opportunity cost involved in this. And ideally speaking, we can also the cost functions and these things also comes under the agriculture economics, like in a conventional and pure economics. Then this scarcity is very much important, and allocation of resources in scarcity. And that's what if I'm agriculture economics, and I am specialized in this one. And what countries regarding the specializations, I cannot teach the zoology, chemistry, and these things. And if I will focus on the agriculture economics and economics, this will optimize, this will maximize the output. Similarly, when the regions do this one, and they become the specialized, and it will increase the well-being of the available resources, and well-being of the people from the available resources. For instance, Faisalabad, this is somehow practical example, but we can see that Faisalabad is very rich in wheat, Multan is very rich in mango, and Swat is rich in apple production. So imagine when Faisalabad want to be a self-sufficient, so what he will do, what the managers of Faisalabad will do, he will actually produce the apples, some of the acreage he will produce the apple and mango. But what will happen, because Faisalabad is specialized and its soil is suited to wheat production, they should produce the wheat. And if they will produce the wheat, then the wheat production will be increased a lot, and then and this available wheat will be in surplus regarding the consumption of wheat for the Faisalabadian. So what they can do, they can trade the surplus wheat from the surplus mango production in Multan, because in Multan mango productions, if they will consume, again the mango will be left behind as a surplus. So what they can do, they can trade the mango Faisalabadian, that Faisalabad can trade the wheat from the surplus of the mango production from Multan. So it means by only production the wheat, he can trade apple and mango, and the their net well-being will be increased. So and this is the very famous discussion in agriculture economics, because every country is rich in some of the resources. So here the trades come. For example, Pakistan is rich in salt production, and India is rich in coconut production, right? And in Pakistan, coconut is very costly. One piece of coconut is like 200 or 300 rupees, and in India it's hardly 1 or 2 rupees per piece. So what they can do, they can trade the coconut with the salt of Pakistan, and similarly salt is very much costly in India. So this is when we trade the agriculture products with different countries, and we will see in the later on in the marketing of agriculture product, and when we do the value addition of these agriculture products, the net well-being increase. So this is how in agriculture the scarcity and allocation of resources actually works in reality. Next, these are the some definitions, conventional definitions of the economics, and we will see how these are linked to the, in a formal way, these link to the agriculture economics. For instance, economics is a social science that deals with how consumer, producer and society choose among the alternative use of scarce resources in the process of producing, exchanging and consuming goods and services. This is the economics times definitions. And then macroeconomics, we have another branch that centers attention on broad aggregates of the economy. So here these are the definitions of microeconomics macroeconomics. Let's see some more definitions. This is another definitions. This is I think so replicated the slides, but there is another definitions by Broccoli, the study of individual decision making units such as individuals, household and firms. This and other definitions of the microeconomics, that's how individual decision making unit, individual household and firms make the manage the scarce resources, and make the decisions regarding the available scarce resources to optimize their well-being. That is a definition by Broccoli. This is definition of microeconomics. And this is another definition by McConnell and Brew, the social science concerned with how individual, institution and society make the optimal best choices under the condition of scarcity. This is the definition of microeconomics. And some of the economics, what we do in economics, that is the positivistic and normative economics. In positive, we see what is the present conditions, what is the actual condition, what is prevailing the situations, and this is the positive economics, and what is the normative economics, that is focus what should be and what ought to be. For example, a policy maker might inquire as to which of the several alternative policies should be adopted to maximize the economic welfare of producer and consumers. That is the normative economics. What is mean? What is your current CGPA? This is the positive school of thought, that is 3.5 and 2.5. And this is actually positive point of view. When we say the normative point of view, what should be, that is the plus 3 or 3.5 CGPA, and that is the normative school of thought. So this actually we studied it in economics, and same principles we also studied it in, that is in agriculture economics. And that's another alternative economic systems. When we see that an economic system can be defined as institutional means by which resources are used to satisfy human desires, an economic system can be defined as the institutional means by which resources are used to satisfy human desires. The term institutional refers to the laws, habit, ethics, and custom of the nation citizen. That's how society mean as institutions by which resources are mean, how societies and their laws and their habits and their traditions, that's how they work to satisfy the human wants. This is the economic system, and there are different economic system, and these economic system, when they their habits, laws, when they decides how they will satisfy, how they will fulfill the human needs and desires and wants, that's become the economic system. And there are some of the economic systems prevailing around the globe. One of the major economic system, that is the capitalism. And here The Wealth of a Nation is a very famous book regarding to study the capitalism. And then most of the contemporary economics is centered around the capitalism, that is we are seeing nowadays in the world. That is capitalism, a free market economic system in which individuals own resources and have the right to employ their time and resources. The capitalism we are studying, when we see that the prices are determined by the demand and supply. This is the matter of demand and supply, and we are seeing nowadays mostly economic system, particularly in America and Pakistan and some of the other countries, the capitalism school of thought is prevailing. That is the markets are decide demand and supply will determine the prices. Demand, people will, what the people desire, what people demand, the supplier will produce that one. But in other like socialism, this is the opposite case. For instance, we studied the other socialism or communism. In this mean, people collectively decide what to produce. They generally collectively owned, and government decide how human and non-human resources to be utilized across the sector of the economy. Like China and Russia, we are seeing that their managers and governments are decides what to produce and how to produce. And they decide by the averaging cost of production of any product, that decide the prices of the, not demand and supply, but what average cost decide the prices of the particular product. In this regard, very famous books is written recently, that is The Capital in the 21st Century. It's the class, it's the best decade, best bestseller book in the decade. This is the very bestseller book written by the Thomas Piketty, and this is more toward this one. And they studied the different capital in different countries, and it has a classic lines written in this book. For instance, Thomas Piketty wrote that if UK and USA will sell all of its resources, then they will be a net debtor, mean they will be in loss. So he studied a lot of the different capitals of different countries, and this is a very famous, and most of time I used to recommend this book, and mostly this is related to the macroeconomics. You have to study some of the macroeconomic principle to understand this book, but this is written very nicely. This is the formal definition from these we have studied previously from the previous slides what the micro and microeconomics, and we see, let's define the agriculture economics in a formal way, because agriculture economics involves the application of economics and to agriculture. We define this field of study as follows: agriculture economics is an applied social science like other economics. Agriculture economics is applied social science that deals with how producers, consumers and society use scarce resources and natural resources in the production, processing, marketing and consumption of food and fiber products. So we can also include the forestry here. So this is the formal definition of the economics, that how the societies, as a broader spectrum, how the societies, that is what even this comes under the humanism and capitalism as well. This is a more generalized definitions, that how economic system, like even might be socialism or might be capitalism, how the societies, in society over there producer consumers, here in agriculture economics farmers and farming managers and farming ministries, producer and consumers and societies and farmer use scarce resources, mean natural resources, their human resources, natural resources, their labor and capital, in the production, processing and marketing, not only not the general products, but consumption of food, production, processing, marketing and consumption of food and fiber products and livestock, and some of the forestry also comes in food and fiber ultimately, but other commercial product like furniture comes from the forestry. We can simply generalize the food and fiber products from the available sources. This is what the agriculture economics is, the formal definitions. So it's a very much important, very comprehensive and very detailed definitions of this agriculture economics, and our whole agriculture economics will be revolved and should be revolved around this definition. What does an agriculture economist do? Agriculture economist, they perform the different functions, and their duties are much broader than that of the pure economist. For example, the role of the economist at micro level, that is the agriculture economist at the macro level, are concerned with issues related to resource use in the production, processing, distribution and consumption of product in food and fiber system. This is the role of agriculture economist. Similarly, in agriculture economy, there are different types of the economists, like production economist examine resource demanded by business and their supply response of different crops, and what the society mean. For example, if I'm producing the cotton crops, and what my business, tertiary business, is demanding from me, which variety he is demanding from me. It doesn't mean that I'm producing the cotton, it doesn't mean I'm producing the rice, and rice also mean what my demander demands from me. There's a production agriculture economist decide in this context, by the by the demander side, he will see that our demander society demand the mean basmati rice. Okay, if the society is demanding the basmati rice, it doesn't mean that a rational agriculture economist will produce that from the available demand. Available demand is what people are demanding, that is the basmati flavor rice. So it is irrational to produce the ED or other type of the this rice. Similarly, in regarding the what textile industry is demanding from me, that is the hybrid varieties of the this cotton. So definitely, as a agriculture economist, what I will suggest to produce some particular. So this is what the lackness is in our agriculture system, because farmer mostly do not know the demand and supply and these ethics of the economics. That's why our farmers are not getting the enough margins and not getting enough profits from the this business, because at micro level, if he will see what are the demand, and definitely if he will produce accordingly, he will maximize his profit. And similarly here, market economists focus on how on the flow of food and fiber through market channel to their final destination and determination of prices at each stage. That's mean if in agriculture economists they're market economists, that this is my production, when where I have to sell it. And for example, if I am a mango producer in Multan, and if I am also a marketing economist, then what I should do? So I should do, I will sell these where its demand and prices are higher. That's market is Lahore, Faisalabad and somewhere else. And it will be irrational, that is, to sell in Multan market. Of course, if we are seeing this in perfect situation, you will see that if the farmer is a 2 or 3 acres owner, and it's very hard for him to come in Lahore and sell his products. We are looking some ideal conditions, like in pure economics, like textile industry owner. If in a textile industry owner, he has the marketing manager, production managers, and he has the different sale managers, and many other jobs are there. They are doing this one, and if this phenomena also happen in agriculture, then agriculture will be boost up. And later on, and even in textile industry, we see there of some of the as very small units are there. They don't have like these production and sale manager, these kinds of these things. That's also we can see that small business also there in traditional and pure economics, textile sector. Small units are there, very small units are there, intermediate and very large. Similarly, in agriculture, it's also happens over there. And later on, we will see how size of the farm or size of the firm, like in pure economics, size of the firm related to the productivity. We will also see here, size of the firm is related to the productivity. Then at micro level, agriculture economists involved at a macro level are interested in how agriculture and agribusiness affect the domestic and world economies, and how the event taking place in other sector affect these firms and vice versa. For example, agriculture economists employed by the Federal Reserve System must evaluate how changes in monetary policy affect the prices of the different food and agriculture product. Like our in pure economics, we studied the at marginal level, that how one unit increase in prices, how the available demand if the one unit increase in the price of product, how the demand will be affected. Similarly here, as an agriculture economist and a macro economic policy economist, we studied if the 1% increase in tax or subsidy and these kind of things, if we increase by one unit, how much farmer expenditure and supplies increases or decreases. And we also studied here in particularly with respect to the agriculture economics, and this agriculture economists do that how the at margin things happen. Okay, then there are many jobs of agriculture economist are there. There is a one department in State Bank of Pakistan that is related to agriculture economics, and nowadays there is a in every banks they have most of the banks they hire agriculture economist and agriculturist for the loaning in agriculture, and there is also jobs exist in banks that is agriculture credit officers are there in different banks because they advance the loan to the agriculture. And how mean this is a very very nice jobs in different banks in government and private banks, the agriculture credit officers are there. Then there is a very easily access jobs, that is the market committee jobs are there, that's in every food and vegetable markets in Pakistan. They have there are some jobs of secretary market committee, that's 17 grade jobs and government jobs. This is a very accessible this very nice jobs related to the agriculture economics here. Secretary market committees who manage the these different fruits and vegetable markets in Pakistan. And of course there are research jobs, a lot of research jobs are there of regarding the agriculture economics and different demand and supply of different agriculture product, trades of agriculture products, and these jobs are there. There are so many jobs at international level, that is particularly multinational companies, they used to hire the agriculture economist for optimizing the productions of natural resources like oil and petroleum in Saudi Arabia, America companies, they also hire the agriculture economist to optimize the resources. These are the some jobs and these are the some roles of the agriculture economist. Thank you very much. This is all about the today's lecture. Please stay away from the your loved one and be safe from the corona. Beat the corona by staying home and wash your hand frequently. Don't touch your hand frequently to your nose, mouth and ears until unless you have washed your hands. And thank you very much.